However, if we have a really good discussion going, we'll use our fully allotted time. So our first presenter today is Phil Moat. And Phil is a professor in the College of Earth, Oceanic and Atmospheric Sciences at Oregon State University. He's the director of the Oregon Climate Change Research Institute for the Oregon University System, and the director of the Oregon Climate Services, the official state climate office for Oregon. Dr. Moat's current research interests include scenario development, regional climate change, regional climate modeling with a super ensemble generated by volunteers' personal computers, and adaptation to climate change. He is the co-leader of the NOAA Climate Impacts Research Consortium for the Northwest, and also of the Northwest Climate Science Center for the U.S. Department of the Interior. Since 2005, he has been involved in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which shared the 2007 Nobel Peace Prize. He is also a coordinating lead author and advisory council member for the U.S. National Climate Assessment, and has served on numerous author teams for the National Research Council. He earned a BA in Physics from Harvard University and a PhD in Atmospheric Sciences from the University of Washington, and arrived at OSU to establish authoring in 2009. So that's all the formal bio. I will tell you that Phil is also a fabulous former colleague and friend, and I'm honored to know him. So there's the informal bio. And just so you guys know, we have about 20 minutes for presentations, and then we'll take about 10 minutes for Q&A for each of the speakers, so there's no need to hold your questions until the very end, but we would like to at least get through the each person's presentation before taking questions. So please.
Thank you, Laura, for the warm introduction. Mel, I guess I qualify as an elder. getting mailings from AARP almost once a week since I turned 50 about a year ago. Do they ever stop? Do they give up? I want to start by thanking Sona for putting together this meeting and inviting me to speak. And I also want to honor those whose forebears inhabited this land for thousands of years. We have a great legacy of knowledge and spiritual appreciation for the land and the creatures in it. And as a scientist, I, Guillaume is gesturing louder. As a scientist, I am in a community that seeks to understand the consequences of our actions in a quantitative way. Native Americans understand the consequences of our actions in a spiritual way. I think both are important. I work at Oregon Climate Change Research Institute, and along with the Climate Impacts Group here at University of Washington and others, we are what are called boundary organizations. We try to connect science to decisions. And this space of sea level rise is something that actually Lara and I generated a report back in 2007 trying to provide some guidance about what amount of sea level rise the Puget Sound area might expect. And the reason we did that was in 2006, you might remember the movie An Inconvenient Truth with Al Gore. Any of you see that, or actually see him do the talk live here in Seattle? So there was an image in the movie of what lower Manhattan would look like if Greenland melted 20 feet of sea level rise. The problem was that in the image, it was today's buildings plus 20 feet. And that sort of implied to people that this 20-foot of sea level rise could happen in the lifetime of those buildings. So we tried to lay out what the science actually said in that report. And subsequently, the National Research Council produced this report in the upper right, Sea Level Rise for the Coast of California, Oregon, and Washington, that was very much modeled on that little 12-page report that Lara and I and a few others did 5 years earlier. And I was fortunate to serve on the committee of that. I seem to get drafted to write reports quite a lot. So I just came off my, I think, 7th NRC committee. Our report was published last month, completely different topic. The IPCC is an assessment report. So the job of an assessment is to look at the entire sweep of knowledge, all of the published research on a given topic, and to assess what is actually known and lay that out. And so most of the slides that I'm going to show come from either the West Coast Sea Level Rise Report or the IPCC report, and I've tried to include an icon showing which report the slide came from. You also see National Academy of Sciences in the lower left, if I forgot to put the cover up. So the IPCC, the most recent assessment report in 2013, had an entire chapter on sea level rise for the first time, and it included this graphic showing all the components of global and regional sea level rise. So the main land-based ice sources, ice sheets and ice shelves and glaciers contribute to global sea level rise. Locally, there's relative sea level that has to do with vertical land movements. There can be changes in ocean circulation that can have local effects. So I'm using red to indicate global, which is going to be my focus, and blue to indicate regional, which plays into some of what I show, but also is going to be more of a focus for Ian and Eric. And groundwater is another global source, but it's not contributing much at the moment. But in the era of massive dam building, kind of in the middle of the 20th century, we sort of stored a net amount of water on land that offset some sea level rise, but that has slowed. Now I've got two unlabeled ovals there. And this is the gravitational effect, which is a sort of an odd thing, but every object that has mass exerts a gravitational pull on every other object. So I am gravitationally attracted to Terry sitting over here and to all of you. It's not strong enough to notice, but if you think of the big mass of ice sitting on Greenland, it is actually pulling ocean water up toward it. If that ice mass disappears, that ocean water relaxes to a level state. So as the ice melts, it contributes to global sea level by adding water to the ocean. But at the same time, it is removing some of that gravitational help. So there's a little bit of a local offset. And we actually hear, we can't measure it, but we can calculate, that in Puget Sound, our sea levels are affected by the melting Alaskan glaciers, which I think is pretty amazing. It's a very tiny gravitational effect, but it is measurable, and it's one of the things that we included in our NRC sea level rise report. So a lot of the data for understanding global sea level comes from tide gauge records, and this is a good long record from San Francisco. This example was in our report. And the data only go up to, in this example, to 1998. But a couple of things to note. One, the red line shows this long-term increase in global sea level that is reflected here in San Francisco as a rise of about 8 inches over the 20th century. The second point is that you see those big spikes with the big El Nino events. On the West Coast, a big El Nino event like the one we're currently experiencing tends to raise sea levels. And I won't go into the reasons for that, but you can see it in the data. The third point here is that if you were to draw a line over a very short period of time, say 10 or 20 years, you might actually get an opposite trend. So we need to look at very long records. Now, in addition to the tide gauges, we also have satellites now that have been flying over and directly measuring global sea level, not just where we have tide gauges, back to 1993, and so that's a very helpful data point as well. We also have satellites measuring the height of Antarctica and Greenland, and also the mass, which has helped scientists quantify the contributions of those two great ice sheets. So just a little background about this NRC report that I mentioned. We were tasked with estimating the different contributions to global sea level rise from the different factors that I just showed you, and also to project global sea level rise for certain time periods in the future, and then also look at regional sea level rise along the West Coast. And then a couple of other things which I'm not going to talk about here. We need to be ready, right? The waters are rising. So just very quickly going to the science from the NRC report. Now, That report was released before the most recent IPCC report, and we were not in a position to generate a lot of new science. We were simply assessing available science in 2012. At the time, there was a computation by Vermeer and Ramsdorf using what's called a semi-empirical approach. It's simply statistically linked global sea level to global temperature, and then projected forward based on different assumptions about future temperature. So these were the projected global sea levels from the NRC report in 2012. So the red are the numbers for 2030, 2050, and 2100, and the black dots are the what we call the projection. We had a long argument, it's not the best estimate, it's not the medium estimate, it is the committee projection with ranges indicated as well. So and these are all relative to the year 2000. So this is in centimeters, so I'll do the conversion in my head if I can do that accurately. 20 centimeters of sea level rise is 8 inches. So we're looking at maybe 5 inches by 2030. 30 centimeters is about a foot in 2050. So that's the position of black dots, and a little over 80 centimeters globally by 2100, with a range from a little over 50 to 140. So that's very roughly a foot and a half to 5 feet as the range globally. The previous IPCC report, which was available to us at the time, had a much lower range, but we were below the semi-empirical approach of Vermeer and Ramsdorf. And this little blue hashed area recognizes the approach that IPCC took to Antarctica. I'm going to come back to this, but the big difficulty with projecting global sea levels is you don't know what's going to happen with the Antarctic ice sheet. And so there was some early evidence at that time in 2007 that the Antarctic ice sheet was shrinking, although the projection said it should be growing, that as the polar regions get warmer, the atmosphere can carry more moisture, so it snows harder, so Antarctica actually grows. That was the projection. But around the edges, it was fraying much faster than expected. So the IPCC had sort of an asterisk in one of the tables that said, well, we don't really understand what's going on, but maybe it could be bigger. And so they added about 15 centimeters for that. Now let's transition to the IPCC report, the 2013 report. So this is updated science. I mentioned that we have time gauges and satellites, and those are shown here for the 20th century. So a total sea level rise from about 1880 to 2010 of roughly a foot. And the satellite data, the satellite data are not shown here, but is very well quantified, 3 millimeters of sea level rise per year, which works out to 3 centimeters per decade, which is a little over an inch per decade since 1993. Well, we can go back farther using a variety of other evidence. So that puts the most recent sea level rise in the last 100 years into a 300-year context. So you can see that sea level was actually fairly steady from 1700 to 1900 before it started rising. And we can go back even farther with other evidence to see that globally sea level rise is fairly stable over the last 2,000 years. So the little spike at the end, which isn't really shown on that, is a fairly big deal, but we're not able to constrain the data within that sort of 20 centimeter range here. So the uncertainties around some of these old measurements are similar to the amount of increase we've had recently. But we know why this increase is occurring. And we can use the factors that I mentioned in the first slide to project into the future. So this is the current IPCC report. And the difference among these panels, so let me explain that first, then I'll explain what's in the panels. These are different ideas about how much humans will change the climate during this century. On the one hand, we have the RCP 8.5 goal, which is sort of uncontrolled growth in carbon dioxide emissions. Let's just burn all the coal, oil, and natural gas that we need to have the affluent lifestyle that we want. And up until last year, it was looking like that was the trajectory we were on. But 2015 was really a turning point, not just because nations signed the Paris Accord, and we probably saw it was in the news again last Friday for the signing at the United Nations, but also because global emissions actually went down in 2015 relative to 2014. Which is very good news. So maybe we won't stay on the RCP 8.5 world. The next one down is RCP 6.0, and then RCP 4.5. And this is the one that corresponds to Paris, RCP 2.6. By the way, in case you're curious, RCP stands for Representative Concentration Pathway, but you can just sort of forget that. And the numbers indicate basically the magnitude of climate change that we expect in this current century. So the black curve and gray shading in each panel is the total sea level rise from all the factors, and then the separate factors are graphed as well. And I want to note that I don't know if we had anything to do with it, but the NRC report had graphs exactly like this, and IPCC had never done that before, and now they did. So I don't know if they cost us, but I'd like to think so. So the main factor, the biggest factor, is thermal expansion in these predictions. So thermal expansion basically means as ocean water absorbs heat, and the ocean is helping us not warm as much as we would by absorbing heat, but as it absorbs heat, it expands. And the average ocean depth is many, many thousands of feet, 20,000 feet, I think, 15,000 feet deep, something like that. And so if it absorbs heat, it grows just a little bit. So that has been a main factor to date, and it's predicted to be the largest factor in the future. And then glaciers, Greenland, Antarctic ice sheet are all fairly small. So I'll break in the next diagram. I'll sort of break these out. But I want to make a very important point here that the path that the human race chooses about emissions makes a big difference. So at the high end, we will probably see 77 meters of sea level rise. That's roughly 2.5 feet. The upper edge of this is closer to a meter, so that's 3 feet. Versus the RCP 2.6 world, where we might see only about 40 centimeters of sea level rise, with the very upper end of 60 centimeters. Moreover, and I'll get to this a little later, notice the shape of this curve. This curve has an upward bend to it. So with each passing year, the sea level rises more. Whereas if we control emissions, again, as a human race, it's rising, but it's rising at a steady rate. And we'll actually look out farther in a couple of slides. So this is for the last part of the 21st century. For these different scenarios, RCP 2.6, 4.5, and so on. So now you can see the individual components. So the red is the thermal expansion, the light blue is glaciers, and then Greenland and Antarctica. And you can see that Antarctica is estimated to contribute positively, that is to add water to the ocean. And this is a change from previous assessment reports, and it reflects the observations. But understanding and modeling what's happening with Antarctica into the future will remains quite difficult. I promised to look beyond 2100, so this is a graph that goes all the way up to the year 2500. So these are the low scenarios, so RCP 2.6-ish, if we can keep the amount of CO2 below 500 parts per million, the total sea level rise in red, is likely to stay below a meter forever. If we reach sort of a medium scenario, it could eventually get up to 2 meters. Notice even if we stabilize CO2, sea level continues to rise. So this is a very, very long-term problem. It just continues and continues. But what about the high scenario? If we stay on RCP 8.5, look at the y-axis now. the very upper end of this range of for the year 2500 is almost 7 meters. So really a huge difference between controlling greenhouse gases and being assured of being less than a meter versus having uncontrolled emissions and possibly exceeding 7 meters. So that's a very, very stark difference in the very long term. Most of us are not planning for the year 2500, but for the very long view, there it is. Now, I just want to end with this last note. Quite recently, a few weeks ago, there was another paper on trying to predict the Antarctic ice sheet behavior. And the problem that we've always had is that, you know, the ice sheets are these sort of big, lumpy messes that obey the laws of physics, but we don't really understand all the details. We don't understand how ocean water comes in underneath parts of the ice sheet and how water percolates through and how those factors might help them break up. But this particular paper said, well, let's look back to the last interglacial, 120,000 years ago. It was a little bit warmer, but there was a whole lot more water in the oceans. There was a lot less ice on land. And if we go all the way back to the Pliocene, which was several million years ago, we know that sea level was on the order of 10 to 15 meters higher. So let's try to model those two situations with the current Antarctic ice sheet and then spin it forward. It's a very kind of difficult thing to do, but they came up with this projection for the, this is just the contribution to global sea level from Antarctica. For RCP 2.6, our friendly, you know, our shoreline friendly world, so it might only add a quarter of a meter in forever. Versus RCP 8.5, where they estimate that you know, we would get to sort of last interglacial or even Pliocene conditions, and by the year 2500 it could add 15 meters. Now I just want to make one comment. This was published in Nature, and the journal Nature, like the journal Science, is sort of a beauty contest. If you wanted to form an idea of what human beings look like, you would not go watch a movie, because everybody who acts in movies looks better than the average human being, right? I mean, we have more, the rest of us have more, you know, kind of skin deformities and whatever. So, less hair, you know, you name it. Likewise, it's difficult to get a picture of where science really is by looking at papers that are published in Nature, because for every 10 papers that are submitted to Nature, 9 of them might have very boring results. Well, we were right all along about Antarctica probably not adding much. The 10th paper might say, hey, I've got this cool model that says Antarctica could contribute 15 meters of sea level rise, and Nature wants to publish it because it's a, you know, provocative result, it's gonna make it into the newspaper. So you will keep hearing articles coming out saying, oh, sea level could be, you know, 2 meters in this century or 15 meters in 500 years. And there is a very small chance that they are right. I will leave it at that. So turning our attention to the West Coast, one of the important things here, and Ian's going to talk more about it in the context of Puget Sound, but the as the Pacific Plate, and we're looking south here, the Pacific Ocean on the right, the Pacific Plate slides underneath the North American Plate. It makes the plate bulge upward. So at the shoreline, the shoreline is actually rising over time, and that offsets some sea level rise. But when the subduction of the zone earthquake occurs, that accumulated tension releases, and the shoreline abruptly falls. The last time this happened was January 1700, so really fascinating scientific story by Brian Atwater and others. So earthquake, tsunami, and then the sea level has suddenly fallen 1 to 2 meters. So this is a really big deal, but it also means that our tide gauge and GPS records are affected by this. And for the committee report, of course, we were looking at the whole West Coast. The San Andreas Fault is a slip strike fault, and that is not affecting relative sea level very much, whereas north of the Mendocino Triple Junction, right here, we're in the subduction zone, and the shoreline is very much affected by that. So when we were interpreting GPS records, we drew a distinction between north and south of the Mendocino Triple Junction. So on the left are symbols indicating the trend over the available records or GPS readings, typically going back to the early 90s, so we have maybe 20 years of data for the best of these records. And then the boxes are the ones that are on the outer coast. And then they are the actual trends over that 20-year period are shown here. So you can sort of see that south of the Mendocino Triple Junction, all the dots are to the left of zero, meaning the relative sea level rise is negative, and north of there, they're generally positive. Now, Ian's going to point out the difference between the outer coast and Puget Sound. And for our report, unfortunately, we only used the outer coast, but we did note that vertical line movements of on the order of 2 or 3 millimeters have been observed on average. Now, I just want to caution that this is 20 years of data, and predicting that the same rates will apply at a given location over the next 90 years is very problematic. So what we did was simply average all of these together and adopt a single uniform rate to reduce what's called the signal-to-noise ratio. So this was the sort of bottom line from our committee report, specific for Washington and Oregon, a little lower than California because of the subduction zone uplift, and which of course could be reversed very suddenly. It might happen 200 years from now, or it might happen during a lunch break, we don't know. We're also not rising as much as either the globe or California because of that Alaskan glacier effect, which is very small but calculable. So to wrap up, the biggest contributors to global sea level rise to date and predicted for the 21st century are the thermal expansion of the ocean and melting glaciers. Greenland is important. Antarctica is the big unknown. The current estimates are that it's going to roughly balance out the additional accumulation and the loss, but it's possible that something very different could happen over the next several centuries. Really, the human race faces a choice of how much shoreline we want to leave to our descendants. If we burn vast amounts of fossil fuels and we get, according to the worst estimates, we could lose 15 meters of vertical sea level rise, which would inundate much of South Florida and many coastal cities. Bangladesh, it would be just transformational. So there is that risk out there. Something more on the order of a meter in this century is an upper end. But locally, some of these factors can be quite important, especially over a couple of decades. Well, thank you.
Time for a few questions, and I'll run the mic to whoever has a question. Are there any questions?
Thanks, Bill, that was great. Do you have any comments on the Hansen et al. Work that came out last summer, which projected really big numbers that were hard to understand?
Yeah, I mean, Jim made a point in that paper that he was really trying to drive policy change. The last figure that I showed with the Antarctic results, this at least was a very complicated ice sheet model where they had estimates of glacier calving and percolation of water through the edges of the ice sheet and so on and so on. Jim was basically postulating a very simple argument for the sake of driving. He's now closely affiliated with the Citizens Climate Lobby. He's pushing a carbon fee, which that's a policy solution. But I think the physical constraints, and Ian Joplin here at University of Washington and others have provided plenty of evidence that it's virtually impossible to achieve 2 meters of sea level rise during this century, which is that was the number that Jim has been tossing around for several years. If you look at what has happened with Greenland, Antarctica, and all the glaciers, how they sometimes speed up and slow down, if you take the fastest rates of glacier flow from Greenland that have ever been observed for a couple years in a row, and postulate that those will not only be sustained but accelerate throughout the 21st century, you still can't get quite to 2 meters. So it's 2 meters is just an exceptionally upper limit. That's almost physically impossible. And again, it's back to the sort of beauty contest of filtering science through the popular media.
One of the one of the reasons for bringing in the different levels of government here in Puget Sound, we have San Juan County and then Island County, Snohomish and Kane, and all of us are doing one type of modeling or another along with several tribes. And what I was looking at and trying to understand all this process is basically the data collection itself, as we're all hiring independent contractors, we're getting independent assessments and different levels of beauty contests, I guess. But the reality is there a way for us to be able to organize our data collection in a way that in the end all of us are able to plug into the same type of system and come up with the answers that we're looking for?
You're talking about something akin to an assessment report that would have not just a report, but a very clear data set and outcomes. And I think that kind of thing is certainly possible. You know, we did it to some extent with the NRC report, where the three states and USGS cooperated in funding this, and a group of a dozen or so experts sort of wrote it up. The products were these tables, and I think Ian's going to poke fun at one of the tables in his talk, rightly so, because you really want something a little more detailed, number one, for Puget Sound, which wasn't really talked about in the report, unfortunately, and I take some responsibility for that. And number two, that you have access to both the raw data and the methods used to process it to come up with these projections, so that you can say, well, my tribe believes that Antarctica is a bigger problem than you scientists said, and so we're going to sort of turn that knob up, and we're going to use a set of numbers that's consistent with, Jim Hansen. And so you have more opportunity to sort of control the process. But the expertise certainly exists. You're hearing from colleagues today who know a lot more than I do about the local factors, and it could be done.
And Ian is going to talk about some work that got funded recently to provide some locally specific sea level rise projections for Washington. There was a question in the back. Was that okay? And then we have time for this one last question, and then we'll hopefully have some other time still for questions for everybody at the end.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask about methane, which has been in the news lately, and is this changing any of the perceptions of where the emissions are going, in our business as usual or some of these other models?
Yeah, so all of these representative concentration pathways have a range of future concentrations of all the major long-lived greenhouse gases, not just carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide. Chlorofluorocarbons, which deplete ozone, were dealt with in the Montreal Protocol and its amendments and are on the decline, but they are also greenhouse gases, as are their substitutes. So there was quite a bundle of gases, including methane, in there. So the RCP 8.5 certainly encompasses any plausible new understanding of large methane sources.
So we're going to go ahead and switch to our next speaker, and again, hopefully we'll have time to come back. And also, if you have other questions that come up for Phil, please feel free to grab him during lunch or at another point. Our next speaker is Ian Miller, another wonderful colleague that I get to work with. Ian is a skilled science communicator and media spokesman working for Washington Sea Grant as a coastal hazard specialist. Ian works out of Peninsula College in Port Angeles, as well as the University of Washington's Olympic Natural Resources Center in Forks. Ian works with coastal communities on the Olympic Peninsula to increase their ability to plan for and manage coastal hazards, including tsunami, chronic erosion, coastal flooding, and hazards associated with climate change. To accomplish this, he uses a suite of tools, including outreach, applied research, synthesis of existing science, and coordination to help coastal communities access funding and expertise to achieve their goals and implement their plans. Thank you, Ian.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. It's a huge honor to be here and be asked to present at this particular meeting. It's also a huge honor for me to follow Phil, who I view kind of as a mentor and as kind of the grand poobah of this kind of work in this area. So a lot of what I'm trying to do, I see as a lineage, if you will, from the work that Phil did in this area 5, 6, 7 years ago. So I was asked to talk about the local components of sea level change in coastal Washington, some of which Phil touched on. A number of contributors to this work, not all of whom are included on this list down here. This is kind of something that's turned into quite a community effort. But really kind of my involvement, and I think the reason that I'm up here today is really because of a focus on doing what I call community scale assessments, sea level rise focused assessments. A couple of recent ones are shown here. The first one that I was involved in was with the Jamestown Tulalip Tribe. And Huntsie Hall's Brandy Johnson from the Jamestown are here, so you can talk to them about the details of that and the outcomes and that kind of thing. We recently also just published for the Resource Conservation District on the North Olympic Peninsula a climate preparedness plan that included significant attention to sea level rise. That's available at the website shown there. And then we are just about to sort of complete one for Island County, Washington. Not quite out yet, though. So one of the observations that Phil made, and that you know, that's obvious to those of us that are sort of sea level nerds, if you will, in this area, is that sea level change historically is spatially variable around Washington State. And you don't have to go any further than, how do I use the laser beam?
Center button.
All right, so you don't have to go any further than the NOAA Tides and Currents website to find some of the historical data. I'm sure many of you have looked at this. These are monthly average sea level data from both Seattle and Nia Bay. So those two communities are located about 90 miles apart or something like that as the crow flies. And Seattle, the historical pattern there is for rising sea level. Seattle is sinking into the ocean effectively. And then Nia Bay, the opposite is occurring at about the opposite rate. In Nia Bay, the relative sea level pattern is sea level is falling, where Nia Bay is rising out of the ocean. So Phil showed kind of a version of this. Mine is much more messy and cluttered, but essentially this has to do with the various components that drive relative sea level change. So he focused on the black circles, which are sort of the big global contributors. And then he talked about what I call here the regional components, these things that affect, in the case of sea level fingerprinting, how the water melting from land-based ice masses redistributes around the globe because of gravitational effects. What I'm going to focus on is the local components. And really, there's three of them circled here, really two that we focus on in this area. And those have to do, as Phil mentioned, with uplift and subsidence, driven in our area by tectonics. And then also glacial isostatic adjustment, essentially the adjustment of the global landscape to the last glaciation, ongoing adjustment. And then finally, groundwater withdrawal, which is an important factor in some parts of the country, generally not viewed as a very important factor in our area. As of yet, at least that I've seen. One thing to point out is that in general, these local components are pretty small relative to the magnitude of projected sea level change. So I threw together this table fairly rapidly to try to communicate this, but if you look at, for example, glacial isostatic adjustment, that's got two parts to it. It's got a part related to the change in the surface of the land and a part related to absolute level of the ocean. If you look at both of those, they're on the order of a fraction of a millimeter per year to a millimeter per year, which equates to a few inches by 2100 of sea level change influence. The tectonic component of vertical land movement is potentially a little larger. That difference between Nia Bay and Seattle matters. But still, it's on the order of, at most, a foot or so in terms of its influence on relative sea level. Whereas, you know, those global projections are much higher than that. So I've heard people argue, why do we even have to worry about these factors, you know, given as a communication tool? And the argument that I make, besides just being scientifically rigorous, is that it's really a risk communication issue. So I presented this slide a couple weeks ago at the SAILC Ecosystem Conference. I'm not going to go through all these kind of principles that I've landed on of risk communication to communities. The one I want to focus on, though, is the top one, in that sort of your message has to be relevant to a community. And in my mind, in regards to sea level rise, that means that it really has to be localized and it has to leave no stone unturned. So we can't leave any questions open on the part of the community in regards to the processes that are influencing them. You know, these other things, just briefly, focus on the numbers, communicate uncertainty. I'm going to sort of touch on that briefly. Be there is a big one. You have to sort of be available and consult with communities. And then be transparent. Don't be afraid of including the detail. We have to make sure that we spell out all of our methodologies, for example. Pretty clear and obvious things in general. So my example for this, as Phil pointed out, when he said I was going to sort of point fun at this table from the National Academies report, is the thing that I really sort of struggled with in 2012 and in the subsequent years, and which it has led to, in a way, the work that I'm involved in now, is why didn't this phenomenal report do more in terms of inspiring and motivating action at the community level in regards to sea level planning? So this is something that I struggled with for a while. So this is the National Academies report, which Phil touched on quite a bit, and this is sort of the key table in the report, if you will, the projection tables. This is an absolute beauty of an assessment. It is so thorough and so detailed. It's a wonderful read. But as Phil pointed out, it sort of regionalized vertical land movement in that area. One thing that I heard as sort of informally in discussing this report with planners and communities is that left questions open at the community level about how relevant it was to them. Because they had heard that their vertical land movement pattern was higher than, or lower than, or what happened. So one key note to make is that in the work that we're doing currently, we're really not changing the numbers, but rather sort of the communication approach that we're trying to employ to reach communities and promote planning for sea level rise. So this is a plot developed as a draft that's going to be included in the Island County assessment. And there's a few things about this that I want to point out. So one, you've got sort of the historical, this is our estimate of the historical absolute sea level in, this is for Northern Puget Sound. This is kind of based on tide gauge records, but modified with some vertical land movement estimates that we've made. And then you've got these projections over here. And one thing you'll note here is that we've also decided to employ a slightly different set of projections, but really a different communication of projections, which were published by Bob Kopp, who's a Rutgers University person, and made an effort to put projections, which have typically been communicated as perhaps medians and ranges, into a probabilistic framework. And so if you sort of key into the legend up here, you can see each of these lines is associated with a different probability. So what this does, I think, is provides a tool for communities to make more nuanced decisions about particular infrastructure or even particular approaches that they may want to take. And this was touched on in the question and answer period. If a community, for example, is really concerned or really focused on some of the work that's come out that suggests these more extreme contributions from Antarctica, the probabilistic framework allows them to sort of adjust for that, if you will, and take that into account. You know, here's where those two references that were cited in Phil's talk sort of fit into the probabilistic framework. Here's the median, but here's the more extreme part of that distribution. The other thing I want to point out is that I've added for 2100 sort of the range of projections. This solid black is from the National Academies report, and this line is from Phil's, the report that he mentioned from 2008, Sea Level Change in Washington State, I believe was the title. So you can see where they fit in. Again, to point out, the numbers don't change dramatically here. It's more just the sort of the communication potential, if you will. And then the other thing that we're doing in these assessments is really focusing on those local components. And in particular, vertical land movement, really trying to sort of pin down vertical land movement in the community. And again, the magnitude here is small relative to sort of future potential changes. But the finding is that it's an important thing to take into account to convince a community that action is warranted or planning is warranted. So this is the example from the Strait of Juan de Fuca. And this black dotted line here is a transect along which vertical land movement estimates for this project are plotted. So here's distance along transect, and this is an up and down velocity in millimeters per year. And this is Nia Bay, Port Angeles, Port Townsend, and we included Seattle here as well. And it couples GPS data, which Phil mentioned in his talk, with estimates also derived from sort of manipulating tide gauge data. In this particular case, there's quite a gradient along the Strait of Juan de Fuca. From that uplift pattern that Phil mentioned, pretty significant uplift pattern in Nia Bay, to what appears to be a pattern of subsidence as you move into Puget Sound. And the difference between these two, in this particular case, is relevant. It accounts for about a foot over the course of a century. So that's got planning implications within each of those communities. And the thing that it allows us to do is really develop community-based projections. So in this particular case, this is a table from the report. You can see each community along that transect is listed here. Here's the probabilistic framework that I talked about. And then we've got a table that essentially provides a set of projections in feet relative to mean high water. In this case, that community is currently mean high water for three different time steps. And then we can, of course, map that very typical approach, kind of just inundation mapping. But the thing you'll note here is these different color polygons, which are associated with the different probabilities in this particular case. And so this might, again, allow more focused planning, more nuanced decision making, more sort of rich discussion within the community about what's important to plan for. Here's the example from Island County. Island County was a little different in the sense that when we did the vertical land movement assessment, we focused on GPS data in this case from within the county. Those are the three black dots here, and found not much spatial variation. So that suggested one set of projections was warranted for Island County, which you see here. Island County asked us to go out to 2150, which was supported by the tool that Bob Cobb developed, so we did that. The other thing that we're doing that I think is that seems to be working well is, of course, to note that it's not just about average sea level. In fact, it's really not about average sea level much at all. It's about changes in patterns of extremes that affect communities. And that's got to do with a lot of different processes, tides and weather, things like El Nino events, things that sort of can combine to create things like coastal flooding. This is a photo of Alki from the December 2012 high water event, which in the case of Seattle tied the previous highest observed water level. And so one thing we can do with this approach is essentially create projections as well for an estimate of the annual extreme water level using tide gauge data to get a sense for the probability of storm surge events coinciding with high tides and coupled with things like El Niños that occur in the historical record, and then couple them with those probabilistic projections. So this, again, just provides a little bit more nuance to the information that we can provide. And then, of course, we can map that in the same way. Maps here are interpreted a little differently. These would be places that may be exposed to sort of the once a year extreme event kind of thing. So I wanted to conclude just by pointing out, possibly in some way, to address Terry's question to Phil, we also just received with a Sea Grant, along with a huge variety of partners, a grant from NOAA to try to do some of what I just outlined at a statewide level. So it's called the Regional Resilience Project, and it's got a few goals. We're essentially, one of our goals is to create an updated sea level rise assessment, if you will, that's designed to be used at the community level. We're going to include storm surge in there. We also want to try to start to incorporate other processes that interact with sea level to drive a changing hazard profile within a community. Most notably, we're going to try to start to bite off sort of wave impacts, which largely have not been included as of yet in sea level rise assessments, but are an important component in terms of impacts to communities, in terms of hazard impacts to communities. And shoreline change, erosion. So we typically map sea level over the existing landscape. But yet we know that over the timescales that sea level rise tends to occur at, the landscape will respond. And so trying to figure out how to get at that in a reasonably robust way is one of the goals of this project. And then we're gonna try to build climate resilience principles into state agency processes, particularly things like shoreline master planning and comp planning. And then look for resilience benefit for ecological restoration investments in Puget Sound. So Puget Sound is focusing on restoration right now, making significant investments in that. And the idea is to figure out how we can try to dovetail resilience into those ecological restoration projects so we get sort of more bang for the buck. And then finally, the sort of final goal for the project is to create a set of outreach tools, including this resilience ambassador concept, in which there will be sort of teams of people set up to help communities kind of figure out a range of options in regards to coastal resilience that exists in Washington State. So with that, I want to thank you, and I actually didn't notice if you put your hand up, but I don't know if we have time for questions.
We do.
We have questions for Ian. And if you could do me a favor, as you say your question, if you could introduce yourself.
That would be. I'm Paul, I'm working on this project. I was curious on your extreme high water event modeling, if you have had any kind of if there's any papers or science that you looked at that, when there's kind of a perfect storm event that's like a really low pressure ice storm up onshore. Winds, something like that, that would be kind of a buffer, that's inches or feet, or what that would look like in the area you're working on.
So, for what I showed you that we're doing for Island County and the North Peninsula, it's reliant on historic water level. And so, there's kind of two assumptions made there. One is that for communities that don't have a tide gauge, that we can use information from an adjacent community, for example, to represent what's going on in that community. And the other is that the historic record sort of contains the full suite of representative possibilities. So both of those are assumptions, untested in our case, but we use, that's kind of the approach that we've used thus far. For the Regional Resilience Grant, what we've proposed is actually some modeling to try to get, to try to essentially model extreme scenarios, things that we might put together by looking at wind records and tide records and pressure records, try to put those together to come up with some extreme events that we can then model and look for, in my mind, especially communities that are particularly vulnerable to levels of storm surge, for example, that aren't represented by the adjacent tide gauges. So that's kind of the two approaches that we the one we've taken and the one we're trying to sort of employ for the recent NOAA project.
Yeah, we have a question back here.
Phil,
go ahead.
No, go ahead.
So it's really interesting to see the east-west differences. Mm-hmm. Do you think there's much of a difference if you look more south, meaning south of Seattle, would Seattle be what you'd expect if you go north-south, or how much it's subsiding? Or do you think there's differences looking at South Sound versus North Sound?
So I haven't looked at South Sound yet. We sort of came up with an estimate for Seattle for the North Peninsula project, just because it was kind of a natural end of that transect. I do expect that there is a north-south gradient, although I don't know that we'll find that the magnitude is the same as that east-west gradient.
So
we have
a question over here, and then we'll go to Phil, and then we'll come back to you.
Hi, this is Patrick Christie from the University of Washington School of Marine Environmental Affairs, and a great presentation. Curious, I'm particularly interested in this one around look for resilient benefits from ecological restoration investments in Puget Sound in relationship to the data that you presented. And in particular, I'm interested in issues about Are there upsides to inundation in estuary miles, for example? But of course, that also there's also issues around human behavior and potential for armoring and the like. And so I'm curious, with the modeling and the projections, are you also monitoring human behaviors and human behavior responses to these kinds of information, and whether that means creating hardening or letting the sea come in, et cetera?
I don't know that it's fair to say that we're monitoring human behavior, but we certainly have endless discussions about that problem. You know, particularly in regards to armoring is a big one, where there's a focus on the ecosystem side to remove armoring, or try to at least prevent more armoring, while at the same time, you know, those of us that work on sort of the sea level side are providing these messages to communities that may lead them to sort of suggest that as an appropriate strategy. We don't necessarily at this point have a real clear cogent response to that. You know, one of the things that I'm very interested in, I'm sort of trained as a shoreline geomorphologist. So one of the things I'm very interested in is how different types of armor respond to sea level rise, right? There's very little out there on that particular problem. But could be something that we could use in Puget Sound to address that.
Ian, thanks for your talk. Glad to see the great work you've been doing. I have a question about the probabilistic wind reporting. Most previous efforts that I'm aware of, including the NRC report, IPCC, and the National Climate Assessment, were not able to assign probabilities to sea level rise because, in fact, we can't even assign probabilities to emissions levels or global temperatures.
Right. Yeah.
Or any of the other processes that contribute. So I'm curious how you came up with probabilities.
Well, so for one, I didn't. So we drew upon Bob Kopp's work. And one of the things that he did is put together a fairly, at least, you know, for us, a fairly accessible tool that we could use to come up with our absolute projections, regionalize, and then modify them at the community scale. So my understanding of how he did that is sort of the middle ranges are based on IPCC projections. I think using the same modeling approach. And then the tails of the distribution are based on expert elicitation. So basically, as I understand it, going into sort of a community that works on these different components and asking them what they think effectively. And so there's certainly criticisms that can be leveled at that approach, but in my view, the numbers align relatively well, so I like that, and it provides a pretty powerful communication tool.
I've been careful about representing that as accurate probability. We couldn't even,
right, yeah.
We couldn't even determine what the median was, right, let alone anything else.
Yeah, so it'd be great to talk more about this. I mean, this is the approach we've used. I'm actually in the process of examining this again for the resilience grant, so it'd be great to talk to you about that. But there are advantages, I think.
Anne Linnea, Island County, citizen activist. My question dovetails a bit on Patrick's. I am really curious if you're looking at storm level data from county stormwater departments. For example, in Island County, we had a huge March 10th storm that is going to result in my community and several communities getting one of those big outflows over the cliff. And it seems to me like checking with the stormwater management departments will key you into some of these big surge events.
Yeah, so that March 10th event was, you know, one, because we're in this active process with Island County, it generated a lot of conversation within the team that we're working with, which is mostly Island County Department of Natural Resources folks. As I understand it, they didn't have the capability to get sort of total water level run-up elevations from that event. We did, you know, sort of gather, and Eric has been involved in quite a bit of this, trying to gather photos, for example, so that we can potentially go back and look at that. That event, you know, I pointed out this need to sort of incorporate locally wind-generated waves into kind of our sort of assessment, if you will. And you know, it's a shortcoming. We don't have a lot of information on that. And so you know, that Island County event provided the possibility of me starting to get a sense for what that added component might contribute in terms of a total water level sense.
This is Mike Cox from EPA. You know, I was curious, when you're working with communities, do you then go the next step of trying to look at the monetizing some of the impacts of the infrastructure and other facilities in there, or is somebody working with you to do that?
Not really. In the North Olympic Peninsula project, we did draw from Surgeon Seas database. They, you know, sort of make an effort. My suspicion is it's a fairly coarse database that they're utilizing to come up with sort of an impacted value sort of metric, if you will. So we did draw that in a little bit, mostly just as an illustration. That, to my knowledge, hasn't been used in decision making.
We had a question earlier for Phil that I would like to have an opportunity. Phil, do you mind stepping up to the mic to answer one additional question? And then we'll get one with Eric.
Yeah, I'm Kurt Nelson, Tulalip Tribes. Actually, this question might go to both of you. First, in one of your slides, you showed California as what was going with the Ramsdorf, Vermeer, sea level rise range. Is that what California settled on? Did they just ignore the IPCC?
No, so the history was in 2008, Governor Schwarzenegger said that the state agencies should start planning for climate change, and he specifically ordered this sea level rise report. It was 2012 before the report was issued, and in the meantime, California planners were actually using this Vermeer Ramsdorf projections. However, once the report came out, communities in California, including the city of San Francisco, started using the NRC report numbers, which were a little bit lower, but also more specific for California, because the Vermeer Ramsdorf was just a global number.
So has in the case of California and the case of the peninsula plans, have they settled on a 3-foot sea level rise over the next 100 years, or a range, or what?
Well, our committee projection for the outer coast of Washington, Oregon was roughly 2 feet by 2100, relative to 2000. And I was just looking back to see what we said about probabilities, and we have not attempted to assign any probabilities to this. So just, here's our number. And it's not, there's a range, but we don't even say whether the range is the sort of, first to 99th percentile or anything else. It's just a range. So do with it what you will. That was, in our judgment, that was as far as we could go with the science. A little more in California.
So on the Olympic Peninsula, the answer is certainly no. As far as I understand, Hansi may have a different answer based on sort of their internal conversations with Jane Soundtrack. But for, Fallon County, for example, as an outcome of that preparedness plan, just adopted a climate change resolution, which for the first time kind of motivates and emboldens their staff to sort of incorporate climate change into planning. So that's fantastic. But it didn't define a certain level of sea level rise of plan.
Thank you both. We're going to move on to our next speaker, Dr. Eric Grossman. Again, a wonderful colleague. I just have to say, being in the Northwest and being engaged on this issue in the Northwest, we have an amazing set of scientists and other professionals working in this arena. Of course, communities who are willing to engage on this. So I think it's always great to be able to bring all of these experts into one room and to bring all of you together in this one room to really stimulate this conversation. So So Dr. Eric Grossman is a research geologist with the U.S. Geological Survey, Pacific Coastal and Marine Science Center. He leads two USGS projects. One, the Multidisciplinary Coastal Habitats and Puget Sound Project on large river deltas. And number two, the Climate Change and Sea Level Rise Project in U.S. West Coast estuaries and embayments. He and his team conduct research to inform risk management related to natural hazards, ecosystem restoration performance, and climate change adaptation planning. He also serves as the USGS tribal liaison for natural hazards, for the Natural Hazards Missionary. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for having me. Again, it's an honor to be able to share our research and work with you all. Even though I feel about 30 or 40 years old, I'm also getting those AARP flyers now, and so I think it's actually a blessing because I can get mine with Jerry earlier. I want to talk to you more about what happens at the shoreline, that coastal inundation and all these processes that are influencing us. And what you're seeing is a coastal storm event that we're all sort of seeing more frequently and concerned about. And unfortunately, it causes humans in the past to armor the shore in very important ways. And that does a lot of impact that we're learning to a lot of salmon recovery efforts. But it's also potentially making us even more vulnerable. This is one of those areas, the industrial complex in the low Duwamish Basin. And we have a lot at stake there that contributes to our livelihoods and economic well-being in the area. But when you look out further to some of the beaches, spit lagoon systems, there's hundreds of these that are critical for salmon rearing habitat. You know, we're really worried about the overwash and the migration of those spits inland, the shrinking of those systems, and the loss of habitat. And you don't have to look far back. This is that March 10th storm event at Iverson Spit that Ann, I think, was referring to. And you can see waves in that photo breaking up and over the first level of the home. It was enormous. We also have really important bluffs and bluff-back beaches that are critical for forage-responding shellfish, seagrasses. And we're really concerned about bluff erosion and the way the littoral sediments work. And we have about 70 miles of rail also contributing to some issues here. When it comes to the big estuaries, this is what we're really concerned with, is what we're calling coastal squeeze. It's the interaction of the climate change processes from above driving particularly a more intense and frequent runoff events that are gonna then produce a lot more sediment. We have a new paper out just in press now that's projecting how the climate models that we've heard about are going to drive more sediment coming down some of our big snowpack and glacier-fed rivers. And it's tremendous, maybe a 3 to 6 times increase in sediment. This is going to be a theme today. You can't ignore it when you're talking about what happens at the shore with rising tides, storm surges, waves, and then the influence of that rising sea that's trapping more sediment in the estuaries itself. So a number of the concerns have been brought up are listed here. I'm going to comment on a number of these, but particularly show you how we're getting at coastal inundation and change and effects on a number of these ecosystem or restoration opportunities we have, as well as groundwater. I need to give you just a little context of how land use historically has changed the system, because it's really critical to projecting how we're going to move forward. And then talk about these impact pathways for estuaries and wetlands, beaches, floodplains, and getting at one of the last ideas of how we can maybe use restoration opportunities to reduce some of these natural hazards. So there's a number of different tools out there that you've been seeing, sea level rise viewers, risk mapping tools, and they're really useful for a number of concerns that we have, but they're probably not addressing the level of need at the individual parcels and permitting scales that we're concerned with, or else we wouldn't be here today. When you think about whether or not a shoreline like that on the left is going to erode or stay stable, we're really talking about that influence of wave energy that's going to be concomitant with sea level rise. And what it is a balancing act of elevation. dictated by how much sediment is coming into the system from either bluffs or rivers and those wave and coastal processes that are operating on the shore. And these are occurring at second intervals up to days and years, and it's really the feedback of that that's critical to everything we're talking about. So historically, especially in these large delta systems, we've really altered the hydrology and the fate of sediment. On the left, you see Ryan Collins's fabulous reconstructions of how, in this case, the Skagit River used to spread water and sediment across an enormous area spanning Samish, Padilla, and Skagit Bays. And then effectively, in 100 years, we really rerouted all that to control the river with these red levees and dikes. And created a really important issue of about 80 to 90% loss of wetlands for salmon and another number of other important wildlife species. But then subsidence in these very areas that we're concerned about, even though we have a lot of sediment coming down, which I'll show in a second, about 90% is just bypassing the system and doing a lot of disruption offshore. And what's really interesting is that during the 1900s or so, we were really managing these systems, dredging and side casting material, which effectively kept those river channels a little deeper for navigation. But you can imagine when the ESA kicked in and couldn't no longer dredge, there's a sort of a natural tendency for these systems to start filling back in, and I'm going to show you evidence of that. But while we have a lot of sediment, it's all about where it goes. There's plenty of places in the Skagit where the largest sediment load of all of our rivers is actually in fact leading to areas of massive marsh loss right along the bayfront. And we have a new paper on that coming out as well. So we put together a project to try to address a number of the proposed and planned restorations throughout Puget Sound. A lot of folks working on this and trying to address a number of drivers along environmental gradients so we can better predict how coasts are going to evolve. And I'll talk mostly about the storms and waves and the sediment. We've used this as a framework. It's a living document of what those sediment loads in our rivers are. They're scaled by these big arrows. We're working in six of the large river deltas and about five different nearshore zones to try to understand all this. Looking at how much comes down, where it's going through the system, and then what it does to seagrasses, food prey resources, salmon, and what have you, and how climate change is going to affect it. And what we ideally want to do is produce some of these metrics that you all can use to help prioritize where within the systems and maybe across the sound we should do these investments for restoration. And so these pie diagrams are one particular metric. It's the amount of sediment that comes down to the systems, to the deltas, scaled by the area for marsh to receive those sediments, and a potential marsh accretion rate, which we can use for planning. We might even propose for estimating carbon sequestration, what have you. But the bottom line is that there's some really interesting variability here with a couple of deltas like the Stilly and the Nisqually receiving very little to those marshes, others with seemingly plenty. But we wish it was that easy. This is a place way out on the edge of the Skokomish Delta on a low summer flow in a small little tidal channel. And if you could see it, I don't know if the lights are good enough, but this is sediment chronically moving offshore, just burying this PVC pipe in about 15 minutes, and it's just a conveyor belt of material, mostly sands that are just moving offshore, kind of lost from the deltas, really important for keeping the deltas in pace with sea level rise. Our work's finding that there's been about a 10 times increase in this amount of sediment being exported out of our systems because of the focusing of flow through levees and such. But it's really doing a lot of disruption to a number of objectives we have. Going back to the Skagit, this really is starting to show. If you look at that North Fork complex up there, 100 years of focusing of that sediment, we think is now reducing the coastal slope for all that river water and sediment to be moving offshore, in addition to creating a lot of loss of seagrasses. The darker colors are the more dense cover. We've been working with DNR to try to understand this. But you'll see what's happened. Right about there in that small inlet or a emulsion channel, in 2014, we had this major change in the system with about 70% of the flow now, and presumably the sediment, coming out of a new emulsion and sort of moving through at pretty rapid rates out to the last sort of functioning eelgrass beds that we have in Skagit Bay. That's a sign of instability of an emulsion. And it's just about getting to those outer seabed, seagrass beds, as of the end of last summer. So it's going to be really interesting to see this in this coming year. So to understand how all the sediment and the waves are working, we've been mapping a lot of sonar and LIDAR to better model and to better understand change. And this is just a quick diagram of what bringing our coastal mapping tools up the rivers helps us observe. This is the channel of the Skagit River. It's never been really mapped in a continuous way, and we're doing this for all the rivers now. But we can use this to detect change and really get at whether or not sediments are an issue for flood conveyance, and then if it's shallowing, temperature issues during low flows. And what we're finding, just at the end of last year, we finished this report, comparing about 30 transects across the Skagit system between Cedro Willy and the Delta. And these are just three representative cross-sections through this area. But the entire channel complexes since 1975 are just steadily grading, in some cases up to 10 feet, which you see here over by Mount Vernon, the Big Bend, and 5 to 8 feet. And in only a few cases, you have a location in the channel where there's sort of an erosion spot to compensate for the sediment that's filling in the rest of the channel. By and large, the whole system is really starting to abrade, and we're starting to see this in the Nooksack. We've seen it in Skokomish, and we're concerned elsewhere. Once that sediment sort of moves through the system and gets down to the shore, it's really about the wave energy, and I want to concentrate on that for the rest of this talk. But the Port Susan Bay area, the Stillaguamish system, is a great case study for us to understand how important this is. There were anecdotal accounts that the marsh there has been retreating since the 60s in that northern portion of Port Susan Bay, looking out towards the Skagit. And the first observed coastal overwash of some of the levees was in 2006. So we went and looked at this in more detail using just nice historical photography. And in the green there, you can see the extent of the wetlands in 1964. And then here in yellow in 2011, on the order of 20 meters of erosion per year, a loss of about a kilometer of marsh that used to sort of be important for salmon and buffer the system from wave energy and storm surge. We've done some of the analysis of what that contribution of a marsh would do to reduce waves, and it's actually pretty significant. TNC restored some of the system to try to recover some of the sediment up to the area to help build marshes. We're now monitoring that, and it's a really nice opportunity to sort of apply what I'm going to show you next. We thought we knew what the 100-year coastal storm surge and wave event was from 2006. This is in the O'Connor area, the Squamish tribe, a pretty significant storm surge that I think maybe even was the impetus for some of the Swinomish's climate and adaptation work. But March 10th, it was far worse, and not much more than 9 to 10 years later. And so we've been developing part of what someone asked about, a coastal storm surge modeling framework. The USGS has this operational down in California, and we're hoping to bring this here in a more robust fashion, but we've had a circulation model for some time now that drives a lot of finer scale models for restoration that we've been using in the Elwha and the Squally and such. And what we now have in yellow are some storm surge models, and we have a NTA proposal to do this in a robust way for all of Puget Sound. And what we do is model in two different ways, an operational mode, predicting out 48 hours in advance every 6 hours, and then in a future sea level rise inundation mode for the NOAA project that Ian suggests or described. For all of this, we're bringing in the predicted tides, the forecasted 48 hours of atmospheric pressure and winds from a European weather prediction model, and forecasting the locally generated winds, the influence of the pressure on the sea surface, the total wave heights, and then the total water surface, and then bringing those waves up the shore with a 1D model called X-Beach, and I'm going to show you all this in a second. The objectives are really to get at these physical processes that influence the shore. You can see here the depiction of sea level and predicted tides, and it's really that atmospheric pressure that was brought up earlier that elevates the sea surface, the winds and waves that then create setup, run-up that washes up the beach face and then leads to inundation and overwash. And then there's a number of physical stressors on the bed that you care about that really dictates whether a location like this is coarse or potentially fine. This is critical for shellfish, forage fish, and a lot of things we care about. So this is an example of one of the outputs. This is just the elevated sea surface due to atmospheric pressure from the modeling we're doing for the March 10th and 13th period. And I show this one, even though it's the anomaly above the predicted tide is only about 60 centimeters, it's a really nice illustration of how specific in space this particular pressure cell was and how well it's able to be resolved. And it's critical because there's a lot of variability when you have a small, isolated pressure system like this come through Puget Sound. And we were able to validate this with some of the tide records that you see around. This is particularly Port Angeles with about, again, 2 feet or so of elevated sea surface above predicted. And then we come in and calculate what the winds across the system are, downscale to about 50 meters, and what the resulting wave heights shown here in these color bars, also contoured, while the tide is rising over the course of this storm. And you can see right at the peak of the March 10th storm, around 7 a.m., right at the high tide, about 3/4 of a meter of wave heights, and about 3 foot of that storm surge. It was really impressive. And then what we do is we have these 1D cross-sectional models that come up the shore. I'm going to show you one in a really important place along the Swinomish Reservation. This is what that morning looked like, the same site that experienced overwash in 2006. And the tide was way up here. The waves were breaking over the road and into the first row of homes. And this 1D model is able to then resolve that wind and wave, well, the individual waves, the wind and wave setup, as well as that sort of sloping run-up that comes up the shore and over the berms, beaches, and levees, what have you, to create that inundation. And this is what the models predicted in blue, inundation of this large area. And this is what we came back and were able to survey the next morning with debris lines and such. And so it really characterized that pretty well. There's a couple of photos here. This one in particular, looking right up along this sort of road here and the crossing of this debris flow across the road and up against the second row of homes. Pretty impressive. It really starts to redefine what the 100-year storm is. But more importantly, for some of the things we're concerned about is then the physics at the shore face. And this is an example of shear stress at the bed. And shear stress is high enough to be mobilizing coarse sands and fine gravels. Most of the clams that Swinomish care about, they really need a certain composition of muds and silts and sands. And so these storms are easily able to erode all of that away. But also these pocket estuaries, which are really important rearing habitats and that we're investing a lot in, are subject to be moving as those forces are scouring the beaches and pushing that material up and over. And in fact, we measured about an actual decrease in the elevation here and about a 2-meter sort of rollover of the sediments into the lagoon. So it's rapidly shrinking under these types of events. This also helps to inform a previous paper we had a couple of years ago that assessed what the likely changes are in clam resources and
about a 25% reduction in just this one area for clam growth and harvest, and particularly importantly from the seawalls. So this wave modeling ends up aiding these sort of previous estimates based on just sea level inundation alone. So I think I showed this earlier. There's these different types of decision support tools. We also have one. We built this Puget Sound Coastal Resilience Tool for six large delta systems that are oriented across those different gradients. I'm not going to go into it, but I do want to invite you to look at it because it does have a number of impacts across time, different scenarios of sea level and storm surge, and you can then bring up these different outputs to assess changes in your favorite system. And we're using this as a framework to bring in all of this extra physical modeling. So last, I'm going to relate this to two other major issues that are going on in these low systems. This is turning that map on its side and looking at a transect from Skagit Bay into the area of the North Fork, South Fork, Confluence, Mount Vernon, and Cedar Woolley. And examining with models how the influence of that 3 foot of storm surge or surrogate for 2100 sea level influences the tides. So the high tide is in bold and the low tide is in the faint color for a pretty modest flow regime in the Skagit. And it predicts that there's tidal influence up to about Mount Vernon, which is right where we see it and measure it. But more importantly, the influence on current velocities coming down the river that move the sediment that I was describing earlier. And I did this for the red color, for a very high river flow, and for that modest 30,000 CFS. And in both cases, the high tides or storm surges are essentially reducing the velocities in the river 20 to 30% on those high flows, several miles up the river, and for the other sort of 30,000 CFS flow, you know, all the way up to Mount Vernon. It's right in these areas of decreasing velocities that you expect all of this sedimentation to be occurring. So it's very consistent, and we do have some capacity now to predict this in the future. We've done this joint probability or joint occurrence of higher sea level rise out of 2020 with the 100-year flow event. This is also in press, and I won't go into it, but just to show you that we have these outputs, and it's also another important planning tool. But what is important is that these high storm surges and elevated sea surface occur about 13% of the year. It's a pretty impressive fraction of time and contributes to this sort of compounding flooding issue. And with sea level rise, these frequencies are going to increase by 5 to 10%, maybe up to 30%, just because of the higher baseline level of sea level. So finally, the last slide is what it might do to groundwater. When we talk to the farmers and a lot of the folks out on the landscape, it's really not about the flooding. It's about draining the groundwater and the water back off the land. So this is a study done by colleagues at the Washington Water Science Center. They measured all of the groundwater levels below the well top across the Skagit system, and we found tidal forcing about a kilometer, a kilometer and a half in from the local waterways. It was pretty impressive. So what I did is I inverted those depths down to the water table for the depth below the actual ground surface using the new LIDAR that was available. And what this shows you is where in red you'd expect there to be groundwater ponding under that exact same condition in February 2008. And in yellow, green, and blue, it gets successively deeper below the surface. So sort of like a freeboard for groundwater below. And what we did is simply model what a 3 foot rise in sea level for 2100 would be. And it predicts groundwater ponding throughout most of this area. And when I took this to the Dike District Commissioners, the ag community, they said, you know, we already see this, not quite as bad, but they do see it over several larger areas of this system. Can you guys hear me okay? Or? Oh, here we go. Back.
Hello? Okay, great.
And so it was just a, this was extreme, but everyone has recollection and history that this actually does occur, sometimes for a couple of weeks to a couple of months, where we have sort of sustained high river flows and these sort of anomalous high tides during El Nino. So this is really the elephant in the room. It's how we're going to face, whether we're in these large delta systems or in those barrier spit lagoon systems, when the water's just not going to be able to drain unless we spend a lot on pumping. So this last concept I want you to know is that sediments play an enormous role in the Pacific Northwest, much more than in areas where we typically gather information for restoration strategies. We have more sediment coming into a smaller basin, which means we're loading up the shoreline if it's bypassing through our coastal systems, five times more sediment power, if you will, affecting our coastal systems. So in conclusions, what I've shown you is that this new sort of coastal modeling and inundation information that we all need really cross-cuts a number of Puget Sound Partnership indicators and targets, and really what I found, a number of really important targets that the Northwest Indian Fisheries Commission has alluded to in the last several years. I won't read them all, but you can see how they all affect what we're talking about. But coastal squeeze is really leading to more flooding, more sediment trapping, and more drainage issues. The sediments are really a complex issue. There's feedbacks to flood risk, substrates and habitats, and human responses to what to do with it. Climate change is exacerbated by our historic and ongoing land use, and improved sediment management will likely help. The performance of land use actions, whether it's to reduce floods or restore ecosystems, really requires this ability to detect and assess cumulative effects across the floodplains, estuary, and nearshore. And hopefully these predictive models that we're proposing can be integrated, like Terry's asking, together, and will help understand this continuum that goes on between the floodplains and the nearshore. So thank you.
So we'll take a couple of questions, and then we'll switch over to Larry, and then if there's time at the end, we'll come back for any questions that you have.
I'll share you know. I'm an interquest from Kuti because I think he does such a wonderful job at finding where the data connect to the experiences of the people on the ground. And I wanted to follow up. There's something that Ian mentioned that I think I meant totally missing. I didn't write it down in the quote, but that when asked about when scientists have these conversations for what are the sociological effects of scientists conversing with local people. And I heard that he suggested there was no coherent strategy or cogent strategy for how to observe those discussions. I was wondering if you would comment on your interactions and where you see the pathways for cogent strategy in these discussions, and if you've seen places where you feel like you've been effective in connecting with local communities or places where you've done yourself to be ineffective.
It's definitely, you guys, one more time, check.
It's definitely a challenge. We've spent a lot of time working with local communities, tribes, watershed councils, taking all of this information on a roadshow, essentially, to share our knowledge and get their knowledge, and it goes both ways. There's been successes. The Skagit Climate Science Consortium is an interesting website to look at and assess how that organization has interacted with a pretty staunch community that's been, somewhat hesitant to acknowledge climate change and use the science, and they come around a lot. There's a new Yale poll on climate change with results just announced. It's been fascinating to see how the real community behind the scenes feels about all of the science. So it's working, but it takes an effort from all the scientists There's others. I think Don, I'd actually rather have Don answer that from just a recent experience. Seems to be making a difference, and maybe that's a discussion for lunch or something. But no more socio science.
One question here.
Thank you for the great presentation. I was wondering, how much have you taken non-stationarity effects into your ecological assessments and habitat restoration? Tomorrow, I'll be leading a short discussion session on kind of, you know, what are the effects of thresholds and when you know, the extreme events, especially on how they're going to impact these ecosystems. And then it's not only sea level rise, but climate change, population growth, all these other effects are causing changes in ecosystems. And so there's a real question on then how do you respond in terms of restoration activities and in planning for these continual changes.
Preston, I'm going to your session tomorrow just for that event. We're not yet in a position to bring in too much of this sort of non-stationary, non-linear. We need to start somewhere, so we're going to try to model what we can do well, but certainly there are these events. That big avulsion that you saw there in Skagit, when we first saw just a little bit of this change, Greg Hood and I had a prediction that it was going to reach some significant width, and it immediately clogged up with wood, and it didn't change for several years. And then it blew out and it got incredibly large in half the time than we thought. So those are great examples, and I'd like to come to your talk and let's explore sort of how to do that, how to strategize some of those.
So we're actually going to switch over to Larry right now, and then if there's time at the end, we'll come back and take a couple more questions. But of course, there are opportunities over today and tomorrow to also connect with the presenters today. So I encourage you to keep thinking of questions. You maybe, especially if you have questions that come up later, don't hesitate to tap on the shoulder during one of the breaks and ask that question. So our final speaker for this morning is Larry Wasserman, who many of you know. I don't have a bio. I'm sorry? Larry. I don't know Larry Wasserman. I apologize. This is what happens when I go on the fly.
Now I can tell my Wasserman story.
I'm working with two Larrys. Okay, I apologize. Well, Larry needs no introduction. Especially by me.
Hi, it's good to see you. In the words of our people, thank you. Thank you for being here. And see you, a well-respected person, so. All of you have been classified as that this morning. Again, my name is Larry Campbell. My Indian name is Wanasia. I'm a role member of the Swedish Indian tribal community. My education, I guess, when we would look at my qualifications, what qualifications do I have here? We see the people who preceded me started from a global level and working down our way to the local level, or the global thing to the local thing. And I always like to say that my prime education was my traditions, my community, my spirituality that we learned into our longhouses that we still practice here and in the traditional communities here in Puget Sound and the Lower Mainland and British Columbia. So after about when I felt solid enough in that education of my traditional teachings that I went off and got a Bachelor of Arts degree up at Western Washington University in liberal arts. So I always thought that liberal arts was a great place for us to go as tribal people because that we were the ones who were going to tell the scientists what to do. So beforehand, I don't have a Bachelor of Science degree, but I have a Bachelor of Arts degree, which basically would make me a social scientist. And we're grateful now that we're starting to see that the science community is starting to recognize the fact that we need to bring in the social scientists into our studies of the heart and the research sciences of some of these issues. If you notice the three presenters before us, they very seldom mention people. What does this effect have on our people? And this is what we try to do here at Swinomish. We're looking at it, saying that, recognizing that science, in most cases, was a top-down process, and science gets to work into a bubble. And I guess that followed the words of Wayne Deloria here when he was at the University of Washington speaking, probably about 10, 12 years ago. He was telling the people that, come and talk to us when you're in your scoping project, when you're developing your research questions. When you come to us and talk to us in this time, when you're developing these research questions, we can get the tribal concerns into the research questions so that they address our issues, and we don't have to do competing science. I thought that was important because at the time I was working in cultural resources, I was working with archaeology, and he was saying that the scientists, the archaeologists, haven't been able to find what they've been looking for because they're asking the wrong questions. A prime example of that, you may take a look at what happened in Arizona with the hantavirus. The Navajo people went back to the elders and said, any idea what's going on here with this hantavirus? And all they said was, well, there's more field mice than normal. And when they asked the question, they got the answer, but they didn't recognize it for a few years later. So there's a lot of knowledge in our tribal communities that is there, but we don't always have access to it. Even me as a tribal member, people don't give us this oral history until we ask for it. So again, this was an opportunity also in developing the indigenous health indicators, was an opportunity for us to go into our community and really to find out what was important to them and to find in the wording to describe that. So that as our elected leadership and our leaders went out and traveled the country and advocated for the environment and the things that are important to the tribal people, that they had more ammunition to describe what exactly are the tribe's preferences. Besides that, it's our sacred responsibility to take care of Mother Earth. We need to give them more. What does this really mean to the people? So our elected leadership many years ago, or a few years back, they decided that when climate change started coming, hitting the political circles and the political discussion, they decided that they weren't going to get into the argument that it was climate change and sea level rise and all these other things were a reality or not, that they were going to say that it was a reality. And then we would start to go right into mitigation adaptation to be able to get ahead of the curve instead of being behind the curve, as tribes quite often are. And to look at climate change and figure out how that we could mitigate and adapt to the things that were coming up. I was about that time I began to say that, and we heard 100-year storms. We began to notice too that the 100-year storms seem to be happening every 5 years now instead of every 100 years. So these are the things that, if you're honest with yourself, you begin to see what is happening, especially this year. What is happening in North America is truly mind-opening, and I hope that we would speed up our work as we go forward. Again, so Jamie Donatud and I, who couldn't be here today, we began our work probably 50 years ago. We worked out in the planning department for Twin Missions, since I was the only tribal person there. Quite often, many of the people, the tribal staff, come to me and ask me, what would Swinomish think about this? And it really put me in a quagmire because I'm someone who has a lot of strong opinions, but they're my opinions. But it forced me to think of what would Swinomish think of this? And so we start providing thought process on how does the community think as a whole and how do we get them involved. So the health in business health indicators today has been a process that has taken us probably 15 years to get to this point. And it has a number of goals. One of them is to get our tribal community involved. It's taking their concepts, their ideas, and their concerns and putting them into motion so that they can see that we're doing it and that we're not ignoring and we're not working in the vacuum. The other part is to give our elected leadership to go out and advocate for our concerns, to give them the ammunition and the working they need to go to adequately describe the concerns and how it's going to affect us as a tribal community. A healthy community from a tribal viewpoint, what does that mean? You have to understand in tribal communities that our culture, our traditions, our way of life starts and ends with our families. Our families are truly important for us. If you ask us again who we are, when I tell you I'm an enrolled member of the Swanish Indian tribal community, it's just a short version of who I actually am. Cousin Terry here, Cousin Darrell, that every time that we get together here, we were talking earlier that we're glad to be able to come together and visit with each other and work with each other a little bit when there wasn't a death. Wasn't somebody died in our family, that's when we usually kind of get together and we're kind of spread out. And I call Terry my wayward cousin because we never know where he's at. And I find that I'm very angry. But we begin to realize that we as tribal people, the way that we prefer to make a living is chasing the salmon, the deer, the elk. We're still a fishing and hunting and gathering society. The gathering part of it has been pretty difficult because we've been restricted to reservations. And it's good to see Ines here. Thank you, Ines, for the work that you're doing in Tulalip. A lot of those resources you need to do your teaching there in Tulalip at your museum is these are resources that come off reservation. So we're grateful for the bold decisions because that has enabled us to be able to have our influence extend beyond the reservation boundaries out into our usual custom areas, which covers all of the Northwest here. So it stands to reason that if the environment is going to be safe, the tribal people are going to be safe. And we are, like Cohan said, that where the canaries in the mine shaft, that the canary dies, that the coal miners knew there was trouble coming. So again, if you look at the tribal communities, anytime there's an epidemic, it hits first to hit the tribal community. It first hits the tribal community before the rest of the nation decides that is the problem. So we went on and tried to find concepts that we would use to be able to describe our concerns as tribal people. So one of them that we come up with, and these are six that we come up with, and they went through a lot of name changes, wording changes, because of trying to translate tribal concepts into English is sometimes very elusive. And it don't always work right, but we kept them simple. As we begin to share them with other tribes in the state of Washington, in Canada, and across the nation, in hopes that it could be a concept that other tribal people could use. But our first concept we talked about is community connection. Community connection. What is community connection? We work together as tribal communities. Our tribe is called the Swinomish Indian Tribal Community. Why? Because our tribe is made up of four different tribal groups that make up the Swinomish Indian Tribal Community. So with that, that means that we have different families, different relationships within each other. But we're taught to share. We're taught to share, we're taught to remember our people. We're also taught to, you know, hate things, you know, in a good way. what is good for our community. We're encouraged as people not to be individuals, but to be, look to the community first. Our second category here is resilience. We faced a lot of struggle, people. But we begin to realize, I guess, maybe back in the 60s, where we saw a resurgence into our tribal traditions and cultures and spirituality, that we need to be proud of who we are as Native American people in order to be able to be strong, be productive, and to carry out the work that we do with honor and respect. We need to have a strong sense of who we are as tribal people. To remember, we teach our children to know who their parents are, who their grandparents are, both sides of the family, the great grandparents. I identified myself with an Indian name. We had a ceremony in Sutter this year last summer. That one family went back 11 generations. They went back 11 generations to fight this Indian name, to put on this person, which goes on to mean that it's a great responsibility. Sustainability is so important to the tribes because we work hard to sustain this fishing and hunting and gathering community that makes us well. We know that as the U.S. federal government tries to make farmers out of us, I would say, what happened if we told the farmers they had to be fishermen? And that brings cultural dysfunction, it kind of brings cultural disassociation, and we begin to forget the things that make us strong as people. Our next category is education, the teachings. We talk about our teachings that there are a lot of it is oral and history. We have an oral society here in Swinomish. I'm one of our traditional speakers, but I'm only one of many. And we get up and talk about how we need to be as tribal people in open forums. But they're very general. But what we do is that we ask our young people to think about these things, and if they want to go deeper, to come to our home or come and talk to us privately so that we can go deeper into it. We realize that if we say one thing to one person, that it might confuse us from over here. So we save it for the deeper discussion that we can have privately. The anthropologists and the historians have tried to convince us that we need to record our histories, our traditions, our teachings, so they don't get lost. But we always say that, do we want our young people to go to the books, or do we want them to go to the elders? We want them to go to the elders. We don't want to destroy that. We don't want to destroy that. What are these teachings? Is that I can remember one of the grandmothers telling my friend, it's time to go out with the marsh team. He said, yeah, okay. And this is how she taught him. What time of the year to gather the marsh team? He already knew where to get it because he had been out there with his father, his parents, and his grandparents, and great-grandparents before. He knew where to get it. This was her way of teaching him when it was right and when it was ready. The little things that you know that makes it successful. Our youth is so important to us today. We're looking at education, we're looking at Western education, but we're also looking at our tribal education too. Because when we send our kids to the public schools, we need them to be extremely proud of themselves, of who they are as tribal people. Self-determination, this has been a huge word in the tribal communities for ever since the treaty's been signed. Self-determination, self-government, that let us be able to provide and our own policies, our own ordinances, and design our own studies in the way that we're going to do things. And we do that. We've been doing that here in the city. It's been a long, slow process, but we've moved incrementally because we do have a stable community, we have a stable government. Our elected leaders stay there for a long time. That way we get continuity as the way that we do things. But again, this stability will provide healing and restoration. We have a lot of intergenerational pain that's into our communities that we're trying to overcome. We're trying to develop trust within each other, and we're trying to find this trust into the Western communities and the Western governments, the United States government, the state of Washington, Skagit County, County of Honor, County of course. So, again, we're starting to make our presence felt. We always think the bold decision. I think that one of the important aspects of the bold decision in 1974 was that it didn't say the tribes had the right to catch 50% of the harvest salmon, but when we go to phase two of it, it kind of mandated the state of Washington had to consult with the tribes as their projects would have the need of adversarial health on the salmon. So we had to work really hard to build our scientific capabilities to be able to consult with the state of Washington and do things in a good way. Took a long time, but it's starting to work, you know, we're running into problems this year because of the coral salmon. Cultural use. Again, the culture use is things that we've been following from time immemorial. There's so much teaching within having respect and stewardship of the resource. Again, that we say, take what you need and leave the rest. One day we were on the river fishing with my friend. We were talking how to fish, and he said, "Well, let's go come have a beer." And I said, "Well, catch some fish." He said, "Oh, well, let's get out of the way. Our brothers need to catch some fish." He says, "If we catch all the fish, we have to load a buddy that we did." So. But we had to think of our brothers. One thing that I heard at our first salmon ceremony that all of our tribes are beginning to get ready for and prepare for now, because this agreement we have with the salmon people that they will continue to come back and provide for us as long as that we give them honor and respect, and that's what our first salmon ceremonies are, just to be able to show that we still have that respect for our salmon people. Wayne Deloria also said that time that I heard you talk at the University of Washington, he said, "I'm not gonna worry about the tribes in the Northwest, because you still conduct your ceremonies. You still follow that ancient way of life." And he said, "So as long as you do your ceremonies, you're going to be okay." Sense of place. This is the shared thing that we hear in our colleges and our universities today. Sense of place. We as tribal people say that we're not going anywhere. This is our home. We're incredibly dedicated to our homeland. We're incredibly dedicated to our families, so we don't go very far. Out of 900 tribal members at Twin Missions, probably 80-85% of them live within an hour and a half, live on the reservation or within an hour and a half away. Practice. Again, if we go out and gather these things that we need in the past, that we still need yet today, then we will continue to keep that place going. We will continue to make our young people strong so they can carry on, so they get that inherent teaching that is there to take care of their homeland. I once, when I first met Sono, I think we were working in the planning circles. That's where I got my start on the first work, first tribe. Basically, when the planner says that the only thing you have to know about planning is that the ship runs downhill unless you bump it. Natural resource security is our last category here. And this is that we need access. We need access to our natural resources, the things that are important is where we have to gather. Our gatherers who go out and gather plant materials and foods and stuff get irritated when we have to ask national parks, state parks, or one of the other state agencies for permission to go onto land to gather these things. We have to get a permit to get cedar bark. We have to do a lot of different things. And having to realize that there's a spiritual component also within it that makes it stronger as we begin to follow the ways of our ancestors. Make no mistake about it, when we go back to our culture, we're going back to the foundation of who we are as tribal people. And this is going to make us successful no matter what we do. And we are starting to develop the capability to have our scientists argue for your side. But at the same time, what we'd rather see is that our community works with the scientists in order to focus these research questions on the things that are important to the tribe. And I think that when you find out you take care of these concerns for the tribes, it's going to have a universal effect also. Not just for the tribes, but for all of North America. I think it was Governor Long who said one thing, that extinction is not an option in talking about the Senate. We need to be able to continue to remind the state of Washington that extinction is not an option. Let me close here by just talking a little story about that happened into our community that kind of got me down this path. One day the same grandmother who I talked about earlier, she said it was time to go to Whidbey Island and get mussels. So me and my friend went up to Whidbey Island. We got the mussels, we brought them back, we cooked them on the beach. And we put an open invitation out to our community for everybody to come down and help themselves with the mussels. We usually like to go to the beach the first nice day of spring. And as we got done cooking the mussels and the community started coming down, I saw one of our elders sitting there eating mussels. And she was eating really, really fast. And then every now and then I'd see her reaching her purse and grab something and throw it in her mouth. And so I was asked her son, I said, why is your mother eating so fast? He said, go ask her. So when I went to ask her, she said that, well, I'm going to get sick here pretty soon. That's why I'm eating Benadryl. And I said, if the muscles are going to make you sick, why are you eating? Why do you continue to eat it? She says, because my spirit demands it there. My spirit demands it. So if our health department, or the state health department, county health department, puts out a notice, don't eat the clams. Our people won't eat the clams just because their spirit needs it. The doctors have told you that when you crave something, that's your body saying that you're deficient in that nutrient and that you need that to be able to be healthy. For us, our spirit is just as important as our body. And so she knew that she needed to make her spirit strong to fight the health effects that she was facing at that particular point in time. So again, this was a concept that I didn't realize at 30, but at 50 I began to understand what she was talking about. All of a sudden I couldn't get enough of that. Then I didn't have a boat, I didn't fish no more. Hard time digging clams. Are kind of going after crabs. And then you depend on the generosity of your own people, your fishermen, the people who come to be able to provide that for you. This is another thing that we say the culture tells us to be generous. To be generous, you remember your old people. I tell our duck hunters, I said, if there's an elder in our community wishing for duck in the morning and you have them on his doorbell by the afternoon, that means that and that you have something that is special because he was able to hear the wish of that elder. This is what we hope to continue in tribal country. We hope that these concepts here that we love to see could be used by other tribes. I think that we also realize it could be used by the non-Indian communities to go back into the communities and to find out what is really important to talk to people who never know who to tell them. And that is us. We are rapidly coming up to speed, and we thank you for your attendance here, your kind attention, and I hope that something we left you here with today will be useful for you. Bye.
So we have just a couple of minutes before lunch, and I know that Ed Knight has asked if he could ask a question for the three scientists, but I do want to give anybody an opportunity to ask if they have a question for Larry, just to give people that chance.
Thank you very much, Larry. And in your experiences in trying to work with scientists and policymakers with these types of ideas and importance, so it can inform the science and policy, are there some best practices about how to best engage with communities to be able to do that?
Well, it takes an in-depth knowledge of your community and how they communicate, how they like to communicate. And of course, when we start looking at a community events and swim race, a lot of our organizers will go and pick their own family. And so that's kind of what I did, is I went to people I knew. And we first started off with 100 interviews, going out and getting interviews from 100 different people. We had to hire 3 different people to be able to do that, just because you know, there are tensions in our community that that we need to be able to, we wanted the people who are being interviewed to be open and honest, and then you have somebody there of their family that they can trust. So it was kind of a process, and then every step of the way, just learning about the community and finding the unsaid things. In tribal communities, a lot of it is unsaid also, so how do you get to that that is unsaid? And it's different in every tribal community because the dynamics are different. But again, I think that once you get the tribal communities, if you can pinpoint what their concerns are, and you put it into motion, and they see that you're putting it into motion, that it wasn't just a fruitless exercise, that they will then buy into that process, and they will continue to ask our staff people and our elected leadership, what is happening here, what is going on there. And I think that's the great thing about our tribal communities, once that we put that out there, they know that we can identify it, they will let our scientists and our staff people go to work and be able to do their jobs in a good way. Again, that just takes, it took us 15 years. It took us 15 years to get to this point. And I say we're only probably a quarter of the way through this process, that it has the potential to go a lot of ways. And I think that people would take concepts like this within their own communities, that if we get buy-in to the science part of it, I said we have to get away from competing science. I work with archaeologists, and you know them, that one archaeologist will get up and talk about conclusions on the evidence they see, and then archaeologists will get up and tell them they're wrong. that's just the way it is. We hope that science can be more of a collaborative effort. But also, learning as the social science comes into the scientific world, the hard science research world, I think that there should be, every 5 or 10 years, there should be a refresher course back to the social aspects of it. What does it mean to peak? So they don't lose sight of their work and their goals. What does it mean to peak?
Thank you.
Thank
so
you.
At this point, I'm going to hand the mic over to Sona, who can give us the update on lunch and the afternoon's activities.
Well, that was really quite informative, and to have it come all the way back to people, I think is why we're all here. I just love to hear, to see all these principles of tribal resilience that Larry just talked about, because that's the original adaptive model. So this afternoon, we'll be going into small group working sessions, and we'll be using a process called open space, in which the people that are in the room, you have the opportunity to bring your questions and your ideas. And if you'd like to host a conversation, we'll have materials out front, and we'll be going through it formally after lunch to explain how this happens. But this is the place where all the knowledge and wisdom that's in the room can really be brought to bear in those deeper conversations. That it's really hard to have that in most conference settings. And so I really value that process. I have to say that open space is an indigenous process. It's used in circles worldwide. So that's what's coming up in the afternoon. We'll be having lunch here in a minute. But before we go off to lunch, I finally had my coffee, so I'm like, oh yeah. I have to tell you that we have many sponsors and many people that have brought this whole meeting together. So our sponsors are NRCS and Roy Lane, thank you. NOAA helps sponsor us, thank you, Will. King County is helping to sponsor us, and thank you, Christy True. And the Fish Commission has been active on all of our committees and helped to get the words out to the tribes. And the partnership has been active in our committees and helping to identify and invite the local integrating organizations. So, did I miss anybody? Oh, yes, I did. I missed the two key people that have helped pull the whole technical side of the meeting together are Laura from the Climate Impacts Group and Phil Moe from OCRI. And so I thank you both because this meeting happened in quite short order, and it would not be the quality and the focus that it is without especially the guidance of Phil and Laura. Becky Smythe has been really key in supporting all of the both all the committee work on the technical side and on the invitation side, and Mike Cox has been there. So, Eliza, are you here? There she is. So Eliza Innes from the Fish Commission has also brought tremendous experience and knowledge. So we really have, I think, quite a good program. And we have quite a diversity of people in the room. But I will we'll let that diversity reveal itself in our open space after lunch, and we'll go into that. Are there any? So I believe that the lunch is ready.